Alright, so we're just going to jump right in and solve a problem where we're given a cantilever beam, right, with a uniformly applied load and a concentrated force. This concentrated force is at an angle, so we have a vertical component and a horizontal component. Now, in a previous video, we've already solved for all the reactions. So if you want to see that, you can definitely go check it out. But here, you know, we have our vertical component, horizontal component, uniformly distributed load. Our reactions at the support, which rigid support include, you know, reactions of vertical force, moment and a horizontal force. So, you know, at point A, what we have are all those components. So we can, you know, already solve our reactions. We're just going to jump right in to the shear diagram. All right. So to get started, again, what we're going to do here is we're going to go up, and anytime we see shear that goes up or force that goes up, we are going to go up on our shear diagram. So we're going to start, you know, at zero at the fixed support. We're going to go up to, you know, 2.2 or 2.2 kips or 2,200. pounds here, right? And that is going to bring us up to our starting point in our shear diagram. So let's draw a line there. All right, and then with uniform loads, right, we have to consider every foot we come over, we're going to start dropping the magnitude of the uniform load. So as we come over 1 foot, you know, we're going to come down to 2,000 pounds. And as we come over another foot, we're going to come down, you know, additional weight. So as we come down 1 foot, you know, we're going to come to, you know, 2,000 pounds. And for every, you know, 5 feet, we're going to drop 1,000. So if I come over 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, I'm dropping 1,000. So all of a sudden you see a line that starts to form here. But you'll notice that this line doesn't actually go through the 0 point. So let's draw that line in. But when we draw that line in, we know that it's going to drop a total distance of, well, what do we have? 200 times 8. Well, the shear will drop. You know, shear drop is 200 pounds per foot times 8 feet. What's that? 1,600 pounds. Or, you know, the shear will drop, in other words, 2,200 pounds minus 1,600 pounds. So we're going to end up, you know, at 600 pounds over here when we're done. So let's draw that in. And anytime we know that we have a force that we know, we're going to just label that. So on the x or on the y-axis here, we're going to label the shear axis. We're going to label that that point, you know, and if you want to, you can put a little dots over or something, but that point is 600 pounds. Okay. And you'll notice the shear doesn't change between the end of the uniform load and the 600 pounds. So we're just going to come straight over and then down. And once we do that, our shear diagram is complete. So we could come in here, you know, if we like to shade these things in. I like to shade them in just because I think it's pretty. But, you know, it helps you to maybe visualize what the diagrams look like. And sometimes it helps also with the areas. So we have that shaded in. We're good. And we've just completed drawing our shear diagram, right? So to go to our moment diagram, what we want to do next is we need to figure out areas, right? Because we're going to integrate from left to right. We got to figure out what some areas are. So the two areas that kind of pop out to me are, one, I want to do, you know, for this uniform load. So I'm going to do an area where I'm going to take, you know, this whole area and of this trapezoid, I'm going to call this area one. And likewise, I'm going to take this, you know, smaller rectangle and call this area two. So what we can do is we can come over here, we can find those areas. So area one is just going to equal, you know, what do we have for the rectangle? We have 2,200 pounds, you know, plus 600 pounds. All that's going to be divided by 2 and multiplied by this, the length or the width of this triangle or trapezoid, which is going to be 8 feet. So when we do that out, we get a value of 11,200 foot-pounds. Okay, so that's our, you know, change in moment, essentially from, you know, this first point, point A, all the way up to where the uniform load ends. So then we can look at area 2, and area 2, you know, we know the height of this thing is 600 pounds, so we're just going to take 600 pounds, multiply that by the width, which is 2 feet, so, you know, 600 times 2 feet, and we get, you know, 1,200 foot-pounds. Okay, so we have two moments here, you know, foot-pounds are in moment. And what we want to do next is we want to figure out, well, if that's the case, you know, where are we in terms of our moment diagram? And again, it's really important to understand a moment diagram here. So if we think of this beam being deflected, right? This beam is going to start to curve down. And anytime a beam curves down like that, right, you're going to have bending that looks sort of like this, right? And what that means is you're going to have tension on the top, compression on the bottom. And this is going to cause a moment that looks something like that. Well, our positive sign convention for moment says a moment, you know, on the left side of a cut has to, you know, cause tension on the bottom and compression on the top, right? A negative moment is going to be the opposite of that. So the negative moment is going to cause tension on the top, compression in the bottom. And you'll notice, right, when we're looking at a cantilever beam like this, when it's deflecting down, like this one is, we have tension on the top, compression on the bottom, which matches, right, our negative sign convention here. So this matches our negative sign convention, and we are going to call this a negative moment. So when we start, right, when we start at, let's call, you know, this point zero, right, we'll call this, you know, point one and this point two, we're going to go find the moment at those points. So the moment at zero is just going to equal, really, the moment at A. But again, we have to take a look at our internal moment sign convention. We know that this is a negative moment, right? This arrow direction is counterclockwise, matches the arrow direction, which is counterclockwise for our internal sign convention of negative. So internal moment is going to be negative at this point. So what we're going to say is the moment at zero is going to equal minus 12,400 foot-pounds. And when we know that, that kind of shapes the whole rest of the problem. So what we're going to do here is we're just going to come down to, you know, minus 12,400, right? So let's call this minus 12,400 foot-pounds, right? And this will be our point here. And what we know is we can connect, you know, we'll start, you know, our moment diagram will immediately jump down to 12,400. Put a line in there. So once we have that line in, we want to start looking at what's next, right? And what's next is the next moment. So we're going to come to our next point of interest, this point one, and we're going to try and find the moment at, you know, at one. And what that is, you know, we start at zero, we work all the way across, and as we go, we add up moments. So we're going to add up this minus 12,400. We're going to add all this area to get the moment at one. So this is just going to be the moment at zero, you know, plus the area at one. So what do we get? We get, well, minus 12,400 foot-pounds, you know, plus this 11,200 foot-pounds. And when we do the math out, that gets us to the moment at one equals minus 1,200 foot-pounds. So we can come back and we can plot that on our graph, and we're going to plot that somewhere, you know, around here. So this is going to be minus 1,200 foot-pounds. Okay, so when we look at this next, right, we want to just, let's just come back to this point. Let's find the moment at two, make sure it goes back to zero. But the moment at two, hopefully you can see this. This is M1 plus A2. And if we look at this, this is minus 1,200 plus 1,200. And last time I checked, that was 0 foot-pounds. So that's good. We come back to zero. And all we have left now is to draw the in-between. And if we think about this, the height of the shear diagram is going to equal to, or be equal to, the instantaneous slope of the moment diagram. And what we want to look at here is, well, we have a positive slope here, a positive height here, a positive height here. So the slope is always going to be positive, right? But what you'll notice is that 2200, it's a lot bigger than 600. So the slope at the beginning is going to be bigger than at the end, right? So the slope at the beginning is going to be steeper, the slope at the end is going to be shallower. Okay, so hopefully that makes a little bit of sense, but what that does, it informs the idea that this is going to be a constantly changing slope or a parabola, and this is going to, you know, slope in some way that looks kind of like that. If you don't get the curve perfect, you know, that's okay. Your you know, teacher will forgive you. You can also come back and write this, you know, do this again. You can do this as many times as you want. That looks too straight. You can do this as many times as you want to get it to where you like it, okay? So that looks decent, you know, but what I want to do next is I want to look here, and I say, well, I know that this, you know, this section between 1 and 2 is going to have a constant slope moment diagram because it has a constant height shear. So again, the height of the shear is equal to the slope of the moment. We have a height of 600 pounds and their shear. We're going to have a slope of 600 pounds per foot, or foot-pounds per foot. So we can draw a line in there, and our moment diagram closes back to zero. Now technically this slope here should be, you know, perfectly continuous, right? So at the instant where we hit point, you know, one, this slope isn't going to change, but this looks decent. You know, this is our slope, and at the end, you know, we have this line that comes back down to zero. So the moment diagram looks pretty good. Really, all we have left to do is to shade it in and, you know, check the box. And after it's shaded in, the only other thing I'm going to do here is I'm going to say, you know, this section is a parabola, And this section is a line. It's good to label those, just, you know, especially in this case where it almost looks like one constant curve. This section really is a line, you know, up until eight feet, right? This 8 foot mark. And really this is a parabola, you know, everything before that 8 foot mark. So there it is, you know. If you have any questions, feel free to drop a comment. Otherwise, if this helps you, feel free to click the like button. And hopefully, you know, until next time, keep working hard, moving onward and upward.